Welcome to There's Sometimes a Buggy, Irresponsible Opinions about Classic Film. I'm Elise.
I'm Dave, and this week it's the Acteurist Oeuvre-view, Jean Arthur, Part 4, and we've got a little wild card. One of the films from 1934 that we did not expect to be able to access turned up on YouTube. It has been there for a long time, so that's on me. I didn't look there. The defense rests, and then moving back into chronological order with the final two films of 1935, The Public Menace, and If You Could Only Cook.
So this is kind of interesting, I guess, because The Defense Rests is the last movie she did before she got kind of her first break, big break, back at Columbia, which was The Whole Town's Talking. And then If You Could Only Cook is the last movie she does before she does her first Capra movie.
Right.
Mr. Deeds.
So we're closing off, really, the first phase of her career at Columbia, which had two sub-phases, as you say. The Defense Rests, she's still a supporting player, though a very important one, and it's a Jack Holt vehicle, and these other two films are clearly Jean Arthur vehicles.
So we first saw her paired with Jack Holt in Whirlpool, which was also 1934, where she played his daughter. He was the long-lost father.
Same year, now they're romantically paired, and they were kind of romantically paired in the father-daughter movie anyway.
And in the father-daughter movie, I think they actually had more romantic chemistry than in this movie. And in this movie, they have quite a lot of father-daughter chemistry, so...
Some very complicated stuff going on between Jack Holt and Jean Arthur in 1934.
Okay, so Jean Arthur's actual birthday, that was 1900, people say?
Yeah, so she was 34.
How the heck old is Jack Holt, just out of curiosity?
He must be in his mid to late 40s.
1888.
Yeah, so 46. Younger than us.
All right, so it's not really a father-daughter age difference, though.
No, definitely not.
You usually don't see that. The age difference between the man and the woman is overplayed on the man's side.
Well, she's playing a young girl in both of the movies. In the other one, she's his daughter just sort of coming into adulthood. And in this one, she's just graduated from law school. So she's in her early 20s.
So here we're seeing more, I mean, I guess something that stood out for me with these films, some of Columbia's feminism on the screen. It almost seems like they're doing something with her comparable to what RKO was trying to do with Katharine Hepburn, that they're kind of putting her into, not always in the lead part, so that is different, but putting her into sort of feminist roles.
Well, The Defense Rests, certainly.
Yeah.
There's no big deal even made of the fact that she's part of this graduating law school class and is an ambitious young lawyer. In most other movies, even other studios might have done this, but they'd really harp on it. You're a young girl who wants to be a lawyer? What?
I don't think it can be emphasized enough how extremely rare it would be for a woman to be studying law at this time.
Quite rare, but even more rarely encountered in popular fiction and popular entertainment.
Yeah, so it's kind of amazing that I've never heard about this film before.
I really liked it. I'm glad we found it.
It was also good. You know, it was interesting, solid. Joe Swirling, very celebrated screenwriter. What are some of the other things Joe... I mean, we've mentioned him a lot, but other famous things that he's done. Platinum Blonde, Lifeboat, Leave Her to Heaven, It's a Wonderful Life. So, as I said, some very celebrated movies there.
Yeah, a lot of work with Capra.
I guess we must have last talked about him when we were talking about The Whole Town's Talking, where he's paired with the other Capra collaborator, Robert Riskin. When I saw the suicide plot point here, I was like, oh, okay, is that where the Capra suicides come in. No, I guess everybody at Columbia just likes suicide.
Oh, sure. Well, Capra...
Because the suicide is, like, in every, practically every Capra movie.
That's right. Some of them would predate this.
They were on the same page there, I guess.
But what we do get is, again, very consistent with Capra, and you might say that Capra is setting Columbia's worldview.
This is before Mr. Smith.
Sure, it's before Mr. Smith, but the Miracle Woman is 1931, and Joe Swirling was involved in the Miracle Woman, too.
Fine, but this seems to be very much more specifically, I mean, this role for Arthur is a big further step towards Mr. Smith, in that in the Capra movie, she's inside the corruption. Here, she is the innocent outsider to the corruption.
Right, but what I'm saying is that the studio is very often, and certainly this is very consistent with Capra, it's presenting a very jaundiced view of the world. There's extra emphasis upon that because of this idealistic character that is thrown into it. And the movies never pretend like the world is anything other than completely corrupt. It's just a question of whether some small impact is going to be made by the person that we meet.
Right. So she's the idealistic outsider here, but also she has the toughness to take on this corruption.
Right. She's not really like Mr. Smith, because she's sort of her own Saunders as well, right? Yeah. I mean, she can do the legwork and she can manipulate the system as she needs to in order to achieve the results that someone like a Mr. Smith would want. He needs assistance. She doesn't. She's really a complete protein in that sense.
But she is undone by love, so the plot kind of has to come to her assistance here at the end.
But it does. That's quite fortunate. This one is directed by Lambert Hillyer, who also directed The Most Precious Thing in Life. So we're getting a sense of who the Columbia directors other than Capra were. We've got Erle C. Kenton, who directed The Public Menace as well. So a bunch of repeat directors.
The styles are pretty plain. Not exactly remarkable.
No, but very effective, I think. And the camera work is good. The story really moves. All of these are quite rapid-fire, 70-minute style movies.
They, of course, decided not to do Columbia as a studio, but this series on Gene Arthur is our most sustained look at Columbia.
Exactly.
Other than the Capra episodes, which are very much colored by Capra. They really do seem to have a thing going on with, even before the whole town's talking, with gangsters and comedy. It really seems to be a thing that they enjoy doing.
You know, I don't think we want to go too far with that because that was pretty big everywhere by 1934-35. So a lot of these characters...
Like what, though? This is not a genre I'm familiar with, or genre hybrid, because I guess I would not gravitate to it, but...
Well, Nat Pendleton, right, who's in The Defense Rests, he is sort of the Man Friday for the law office. He's sort of an ex-crook who was taken on the payroll, a guy that specialized in this kind of role. And we've seen him in Penthouse, where he plays a gangster with a heart of gold who winds up helping out Warner Baxter and Myrna Loy. And there's obviously a comedic element to that movie as well.
Well, at MGM, we did see something like this with Public Hero Number One. I don't know, there wasn't as thorough a mixing. It was sort of like Arthur just came into the middle of a crime drama and turned it into a romantic comedy for a while.
Yeah, that one got a lot more insanely violent for a longer period of time. And there was a much more menacing kind of aspect to it than The Defense Rests. The Defense Rests is more in the nature of a corrupt lawyer film, which we have, that's a cycle in the early 30s as well. There's Counselor at Law, there's Lawyer Man, there's The Mouthpiece, and those are John Barrymore, William Powell, and Warren William. And so Jack Holt is basically taking his try at playing that kind of role.
And then The Public Menace is a newspaper comedy in which gangsters get involved, or in any way a reporter comedy. And If You Could Only Cook has the most comedic gangsters of them all.
Leo Carrillo played those kinds of roles all the time. Although we've seen him before, I think the only time we've seen him on the podcast was in Four Frightened People. But there he was playing, you know, the person that they meet on the island, which is a different matter entirely. But yeah, he did specialize in
dialect characters, his Wikipedia says.
And often gangsters, yeah.
He himself was Hispanic, but...
He played a lot of Italians.
But did not have an accent, either.
No, of course not. No, he put that on, yeah.
Well, of any kind. Well, an American accent.
Yeah. But let's stick with The Defense Rests. This story is very much focused on Jack Holt, superstar, slick lawyer, in deep with the mob, gets them off no matter what's going on. He's never lost a case, apparently. He's won 38 straight cases, we're told. It's gotten so bad that the DA knows he can't win the next election. He's on his way out, and he says, if it's the last thing I do, I'm going to put you behind bars. Holt, he's got a kind of melancholy attitude towards life. You can see that he's disappointed in the world as it is, but he doesn't see anything he can do about it, so he may as well make a lot of money and put on his little shows in the courtroom and get these gangsters off so that they can continue to foment mayhem. He's not gleeful about it unless he's confronted with someone that wants to fight with him.
He's
an alcoholic.
He's pretty gleeful about the publicity he gets.
He's publicly gleeful for sure, but whenever he's alone, he doesn't seem all that thrilled. He is brought in as graduation day speaker at his alma mater. That's where we meet Jean Arthur. She's in the crowd of graduates, and he makes an insane speech, sort of like an Emerson at Harvard Divinity School speech, basically saying this whole profession is garbage. Go seek your fortunes elsewhere.
Yeah, he very specifically, I mean, here's an example of these thoroughness of the feminism of the movie, because we've seen movies before where a director will make sure to include a couple of women in a classroom of scientists or doctors, and it's even a plot point in The Green Light.
Yeah,
so Borsagi likes to do that, for example.
And non-white characters as well. They'll just be sort of thrown into the crowds, but not a lot of talk about.
But Jack Holt, no matter how corrupt a lawyer he is here in his speech, is careful to address the speech to both the men and women in the room.
Everyone, get out. Don't even start.
Become a carpenter or a stenographer or some other honest career.
Right. He gives the speech and blames it all on the fact that he's drunk. But we find out that, of course, that's not quite true. Maybe he did have some drinks to get himself geared up for it, but he did it so that he could drum up publicity because he's not allowed to advertise.
But did he? Because maybe he also just meant what he was saying in addition to getting publicity out of it.
Yeah, well, he kind of gets it both ways there and in a lot of other circumstances in this film. The universe is kind to Jack Holt in this movie. I think he makes him so likable that you really are happy for him.
Yeah, he's somehow like a less menacing Warren William.
Exactly.
Just as likable while playing a kind of a corrupt or heavy character, and yet without a really deep sense of darkness that Warren William can have.
Right. I don't think he's quite as amazing an actor as Warren William, but I'm really impressed by him in the two movies we've seen. In Whirlpool, he's a notorious gambler and gangster who's also extremely likable. Like, there's no real downside to him, and it's very sad when he dies. Don't feel like he needed to be punished. And in this movie, you also feel like he doesn't need to be punished, and he doesn't get punished.
Well, no, in Whirlpool, his death was, like, kind of tragic.
Yeah, exactly. And here, no, he doesn't even get to have a downfall. There's no need, because...
Yeah, how is this getting by the code?
Well, again, this is 34, so it might have been...
Right. Well, no.
Early enough in the year that...
Oh, yeah, 34. Yeah, that is 34.
It's early enough that a lot of things weren't being enforced, and as long as he's repentant, and he is, by the end, he's not going to do any more bad things. So the movie's satisfied with that, and I guess the half-enforced code was okay with that as well, but probably not the year after. That wouldn't have gotten away with this.
Yeah, this has the feeling of a pre-code.
So Jean Arthur, you know, we see her in the crowd. She shows up the next day looking for a job. She presents her credentials, her diploma from the alma mater. She just lays it out there. She knows everything he said. She doesn't believe he meant it. She wants to work in the greatest profession in the world, the cleanest profession in the world, and she wants to do it in his office because he's the best. It's quite amazing.
But if she's, I don't know, how does this work? Because if she's followed his career since she was a young woman, she must know what kind of a person he is, what kind of a lawyer he is.
As we see throughout the film, she wants to learn everything there is to know about law, and she believes he's redeemable, obviously.
Right, she does tell him that he is the most brilliant lawyer that she knows. So she doesn't have moral compunctions about working for this corrupt guy as long as she can learn something from him. And in fact, she's basically in love with him from the beginning.
Yeah, she always has been, clearly. From afar, nothing changes as she gets to know him better. And there's no process of disillusionment, right? This is not a Jimmy Stewart, Mr. Smith kind of scenario where someone comes in totally innocent and has their eyes open. Her eyes are open from the beginning. She's, again, like Saunders, but also has this idealism where she wants people to, knowing everything about the world that they know, without being blind to any of it. She wants people to just be better. And she wants to go into the business, find out all the tricks, and then I guess start using them for good instead of for nefarious purposes, as Jack Holt has been doing so far.
There is a very interesting, tense scene between them where he contemplates putting the moves on her.
Yeah, and she basically says, oh, you wouldn't do that during business hours.
Well, he says that he would, though.
But she gauges him well enough that she knows if she just makes it clear enough that that's not what she wants from him, he is going to stop.
Yeah, he says, you can go to your office, Joan. I'm going to call you Joan. So this is what she has to put. This is the mildest form of sexual harassment that she's going to experience. I found it interesting because it did seem to me that the scene was making the point that what he was doing was wrong.
Of course it's wrong. Of course
it's not,
wrong.
It's not wrong in a heavy-handed way. It's like the kind of sexual harassment we'd recognize now. It's not like she's threatened with rape or being chased around the desk or anything extravagant.
No.
It's very insulting.
The only reason it plays the way it does is because she's ready for it and she has all the answers. And of course she's disappointed she has to do this. But again, she knows what kind of world she's living in. And she knows that all, even her heroes are going to be gross.
Yeah, when we were watching this, I was like, oh, is this Joe Swirling doing a little caricature of Harry Cohn or something?
Quite possibly.
Harry Cohn, who we know of as both a feminist in his hiring of women for important positions at the studio and a sex pest.
Yep. So she goes on the payroll, sort of, although we find out that she doesn't get any checks for like 6 weeks because some paperwork wasn't done and she doesn't remind him until much later when he talks about, are you working for me or not? And she's like, well, in fact, you're not actually paying me. And he checks on it with payroll and it's true.
She keeps saying that she'll work for him for free, which leads me to believe she is independently wealthy.
Seems like it.
I mean, I guess if you're going to law school in 1934.
Or now, you have to be from a certain stratum of society. Unless a gangster pays your way or something like that, like in G-Man. But that doesn't seem to be part of her backstory. So we get going here. The one case we see that he doesn't want any part of is a kidnapping case, a nasty kidnapping case where the child was killed, presumably just to hedge bets against anything going wrong. Or
yeah, but even before that, we get this interesting case with this woman. This is very important. The B plot that...
Oh yeah, well, we should talk about that.
That heats up until the end of the movie where all the plots explode at once, where this gangster's mole comes to him.
Shirley Gray is the actress playing Mabel Wilson. She is charged with murder.
And she tells him the truth, which is that she didn't commit the murder, but the most important factor for him is that he be able to win the case, and
right.
He knows that a lie will be more effective in the courtroom.
Yeah, he's not interested at all in hearing the real version of the story. He's like, no, 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 no. Here, let me guess. Is this what happened? And
well,
he outlines an entire defense.
She tells the whole story.
Right.
Which, again, has interesting little feminist points made in it, in the way she's being treated by this gangster boyfriend.
Yeah.
At the end of it, I was like, oh, well, that story is so crazy, it has to be true. And it is true.
It is true.
But then he decides there's a different story that is true, which is basically self-defense because of attempted rape. Fascinatingly, the way he trains her for the courtroom is for her to look innocent and demure and tell this story of being preyed upon by men, but at the same time, use her sexuality to hook the jury in.
He knows his juries.
Fascinating, prurient combination.
And it works like a charm. She follows directions. Of course, as Jean Arthur mentions after the case is over, this means that she has admitted to killing someone that she did not kill. So a real killer is still at large and the law will never go after them because the case has been tried and verdict of self-defense killing has been rendered.
And it's interesting in that scene that Jean Arthur seems completely superfluous. Like she's just repeating his orders to the stenographer. But in fact, the whole time, she is capturing all of this evidence that she can use against him.
Yeah, this is a tough position to be in, and we don't see anything like this with this gender mix in movies that I can think of. You often see a young man apprentice to an older man going through this kind of process and realizing they have to start working against their beloved sort of father figure. But I can't really think of a movie where there's a young woman who finds herself in this position from the 30s.
I mean, it's really, really interesting what kind of persona Columbia is crafting for her with her collaboration And yeah, it seems really most comparable to Katharine Hepburn's relationship with Pandro Berman and what he was trying to do with her.
So that case goes off like a charm, and there's no problem as far as Jack Holt is concerned, and the little quibbles that Jean Arthur raises, that's fine. That, you know, he's made his peace with those kinds of facts a long time ago. Collateral damage is that, you know, whoever killed this gangster gets to go free. He obviously doesn't care. We've already seen how he feels about the gangsters he defends. The first scene, Ward Bond is being acquitted and wants to celebrate with Jack Holt, and Jack Holt's like, get the fuck away from me. Just get me your money. So he hates these people. If they kill each other off, he doesn't care, as long as when they go into the courtroom, the law doesn't get their hands on them. That's the only way I can rationalize this, right? If it was like a civilian in the parlance of criminal narratives had been killed, we don't really see anything like that until we get to the kidnapping case, where a child was killed. The people involved in this, there's no way for him to rationalize it as just intramural sports and gangland. He doesn't want any part of this. And this scenario, even though it doesn't track with reality in every respect, it's obviously inspired by the Lindbergh baby kidnapping, which was the number one front page story in 1932, and reverberations would have been felt for years later in popular culture. Charles Lindbergh, the hero of transatlantic flying, later a Nazi, so not exactly the most sympathetic figure in the world, but people didn't have any clue about that at the time.
Well, it's still pretty horrifying anyway that a child who wasn't even 2 years old was murdered in this situation.
Yeah, of course. You know, that's the gist of it. None of the rest of it, I don't think, has anything to do with the case in our film, but a baby was kidnapped, ransom was paid, didn't do any good, baby was killed anyway, and that's what's happened in this movie. Jack Holt wants nothing to do with it. Nat Pendleton is surprised. He's like, oh, really? We're finally going to refuse a case. I think it's the first time, right? That's how they make it sound anyway.
Well, Jean Arthur also talks earlier about how he is kind of a soft touch who gives his money away to everybody. Oh, yeah. So he has this soft side that I guess these gangsters don't know about.
Right. He's a Robin Hood figure, has $84 in his bank account. So he's not doing all of this for himself in the long run. His courtroom antics, it's mostly demonstration of his superior skills. That's what it comes across as, right? He loves winning and he doesn't actually care. When he gets in the courtroom, he doesn't care what kind of collateral damage there is to society. But once he gets all this money, he redistributes it to people that need it. He puts all kinds of people on the payroll, ex-criminals. He's not using it to build mansions for himself.
Oh, he hires young girl lawyers?
Yeah, just on the presentation of their diploma.
Forgets to pay them, but...
but he rectifies that.
Too much, she says.
Even though she's got quite a complicated role, she lists all of her functions. What are they? Mentor, mother...
Oh, right.
I forget all of them, but she makes it sound like quite a package.
Doesn't she say manager, mentor, mother, something
like
that?
Yeah, something like that. Yeah. Then we find out all of these years of high-handed tactics, he has gotten himself into trouble because he's been relying not only on his brilliant rhetorical skills, but also on some backup when needed from perjurers who will take the stand at the mob's behest. And now that's all coming back to bite him in the ass because the mob wants this murderer kidnapper to be set free, presumably because he's part of the mob and he didn't do it by himself. It's all connected. So if he goes down, he'll bring everyone else down with him. And so Harold Huber shows up, another Thin Man cast member. Here he's the top man in the underworld, it seems. So a big step up for him. His name is Castro. And he says, I know you don't like this case, but I'm afraid you're going to have to take it. If you don't, well, no skin off our noses, but you won't have a practice anymore and you'll be spending some time in jail with all the people that didn't have the benefit of your services. He has to take it. He still doesn't seem to feel good about it. But once he has to take the case, of course he has no intention of losing it because that would be bad for his image, it would be bad for his self-respect.
Meanwhile, Jean Arthur is playing detective.
She brings in the mother of the kidnapped and murdered baby.
Well, yeah, well, that's to appeal to him, but she's also off finding the real murderer in this other case.
Well, it all happens at once, though, right? Because she brings in the mother, right. And the same day, the wife
of the... Well, the same moment.
Yeah, the wife of the murdered gangster comes in, has some important papers, some IOUs.
Yeah, which Jean Arthur decides to just corral her into her office.
Yep.
And say that I am handling this case.
Yeah, and she does some pretty high-handed stuff herself here, so she's learning from the master. She's bending the truth. She says, okay, look, give me these papers. Don't tell anyone. Don't even tell my boss. I'll see what I can do for you. Again, this is not a case of a woman looking for justice in the murder of her husband, because she clearly hated her husband. And who wouldn't? It's J. Carroll Nash being as nasty as he often was in these 30s movies. He's awful in that flashback. Definitely no one's shedding any tears over his murder. But his wife now has nothing, and she could use a little help. Jean Arthur just wants to see justice done. She is very idealistic in that sense. Now the mother...
Yeah, right. She doesn't want a murderer running around, even though he's probably just going to murder other...
That's right.
...creeps.
That's right. So the mother does get into Jack Holt's office after he tries to stall her off or get rid of her, and she gives an impassioned speech about what it's like to be her and to have gone through this hell. He's obviously moved, but not moved enough to throw his career and maybe his life away, so he just wants her to please leave. Although he doesn't treat her callously. I mean, he listens. He doesn't throw her out. He doesn't take calls while she's talking. Quite a scene. I think the mother does a good job.
Very, very old-looking mother.
It's true.
Is this woman supposed to... Is this what a 40-year-old supposed to look like, or...?
Yeah, well, I think... Probably not far off in a lot of cases, right? And especially after what she's been through, her hair may have gone white during the course of this awful experience.
All mothers just look like this, especially if they have to evoke pathos. Who is this actress, though?
All right, well, she would have been... The actress was in her 50s, so...
Okay, well, that...
A medical marvel.
Yeah, especially for the era. We'll just let that pass, I guess. Maybe it was a child of 15.
I don't think so, because they keep calling the child a baby.
Very strange.
I think it's fine. It evokes the requisite pathos, right?
It evoked in me wondering how old this woman was and how she had this baby. Anyhow, it happens.
Yeah.
You know, I have heard of cases of older mothers, even from decades back, so...
Sure, sure. Her plea has no effect. And of course, what she wants him to do is drop the case so that he says, well, what good does that do? There's gonna be another lawyer that takes the case. And she says, yeah, but they won't win. That doesn't do any good. Ultimately, we see the case as it proceeds, and this one is really being won purely on crooked testimony. I mean, we don't actually see any grandstand plays in the courtroom by Jack Holt. He's just calling up people who are blatantly lying on the stand. So I'm not sure if this one will go down in the books as one of his greatest triumphs, even if it goes according to his plan. The DA, though, is just more and more disgusted, of course. We've seen he's at the end of his rope at the beginning of the film, and this is just unbelievable. The defendant is John Ray. He is just clearly guilty as hell, and no attempt to make him anything more than a real slime ball. Dak Holt doesn't like him. Nobody likes him. Obviously, he's just got too much on the mob. They have to save this guy. Jean Arthur's detective work is going on throughout all of this. It's a wonderful series of steps she takes.
It's very proto watching Hildy Johnson work in His Girl Friday or what have you.
Exactly. And this is so much earlier. We just don't get a lot of women taking this kind of active role in an investigation in a film. You know, even in the Thin Man movies, Myrna Loy doesn't get to do anything like this.
Yeah, and she's doing this all on her own.
Yeah, she's confronting these gangsters and gamblers just showing up at their apartments and...
But I mean, she doesn't have permission to do this.
No, and she's not afraid either. And she doesn't bring anyone with her as muscle. She just goes there knowing she can take care of herself. It's pretty amazing. Once she puts it all together, she lays her cards on the table and she tells Jack Holt, you know, I'm sorry to have to tell you this, but your career is over. I am going to have to give all of the evidence I've collected to the prosecutor. Exhibit A is going to be the notes, the shorthand I took of your whole meeting with self-defense woman.
And given what we know about this guy, I've wondered if he'd have some way of fighting back against her, some dirty way of fighting back against her, but that doesn't come into play.
It doesn't. You know, this is very different from some of the other corrupt lawyer cycle of movies. All of the main figures have some kind of redeeming value to them or redeeming feature to them, but Jack Holt is so much more likable, and you never really doubt that he's a good person somehow, and that's just the image this guy had. I mean, he was primarily a Western star, right? Like a white hat Western star, and right. They gave him some of these other roles as gangsters and gamblers and corrupt lawyers, but he's still projecting that same steadfastness, right? And you never start to feel like, is he just going to kill Jean Arthur off? Because that's basically what he'd have to do.
Yeah.
She tells him, you know, I'm incorruptible.
Well, basically, in any other movie, that's what he would have to at least contemplate
he's
doing.
He's not going to do that, though. Yeah. There's no question in your mind. So that's not a plot point. You're not worried that he's going to wrestle with this idea. He's just like, well, I guess I just better figure out some other way to spend the rest of my life.
But I can't remember in what order it happens that the mother comes back and shoots herself in the head in front of him.
So yeah, this is kind of overdetermined, I guess. Like, there's a lot of stuff happening. He does tell Jean Arthur, yeah, go ahead, try it. I'll beat you somehow. But you don't get the sense that he's going to do anything to harm her. So the only way he could beat her would be more perjuring testimony from other pals from the underworld or something. I don't know how he could get away with it. Maybe Mabel would come in and just say, you're lying, right? I guess that's what they'd have to do.
Oh, but Arthur has all that evidence.
Well, no, it's just notes, right? They could get together and say, okay, you just wrote these notes and I never said that.
There's no dictaphone at this
point. No. Well, there is a dictaphone in the world, but we see that there's no dictaphone in that office. So presumably that's what he would have tried to do. All of that changes when Mrs. Evans shows up, and obviously she's agitated. She knows from the newspapers that the kidnapper's about to be acquitted, and she just can't take it anymore. She wants Jack Holt to witness her own self-destruction, and he's been the cause of it. She was living, I guess, for some sense of vindication, some sign that the world actually cared about the death of her son, and obviously that's not the case.
Well, she says, I want you to know that this is your fault.
You killed me.
You're just as bad as the murderer.
Right. She says, they do these things because they know you're going to get them off. And of course, that's true. That he can't shrug off. It's the 1-2 punch, though. Because what he does winds up being really pragmatic. It's not like a Capra film in that sense. He doesn't make a public confession of his guilt or anything like that, right? That's what you'd get in a Capra movie.
Well, he also doesn't really need to make a moral conversion. He just has to have enough reasons to stop what he's doing because he's having all of these benefits from it.
It's a very different feel from a Capra movie, even though there are some of the same kind of metaphysical questions being posed, but the solution is different. He really is the master. You know, in moments, he figures out a way out of most of his problems anyway. If the mob won't let him quit the defense, he's going to have to make sure that they're all indicted and so that none of them can hurt him. And so what he does is he summons Nat Pendleton and says, go to the jail, talk to this clown, put the screws to him for a bunch of money right up front, or else we don't go ahead. That all works out perfectly. He gets some marked bills, and I guess he was counting on that, because where else is the money going to be coming from for this jerk? He turns over all this evidence to the DA, and this is going to end his career as a public defender, because this is a violation of confidentiality that all lawyers have to observe.
But wouldn't that evidence have to be thrown out then?
He gives it to them. Obviously, the DA is not going to say where he got it from either.
Right, and he says specifically, don't say where you got it from.
Exactly, exactly. And this DA is so far gone that he's willing to, yeah, let's just do this, right?
But in that case, how does it end his career if no one's going to say where it came from?
Well, you're right. But he's really taking a chance.
I feel like it's more like a Better Call Saul thing. It's just his clientele aren't going to go to him anymore.
Then he's able to use this as ammunition. So he convinces John Ray that the mob, they're all against him, and the only way out for him is to turn state's evidence against all of the leaders of the families, or whatever this mob is. So he does. All of them are arrested, except for the one guy that is at large, the one who's the most trigger happy as well, unfortunately, for Jack Holt. So he's still out there. Police are looking for him, but they haven't found him, and all he wants to do, he knows his goose is cooked too, he just wants to kill Jack Holt before the caller happened. Through wonderful
Synchronicity.
Kismet. He shows up at Jack Holt's office, barges in there, blasts away at the man that he sees in the office, takes off, gets arrested later, and says, well, at least I killed Jack Holt. And everyone assumes he's dead. He's not. He comes in the next morning. People keep trying to tell him there's someone dead in his office. He doesn't want to hear anything about it.
But in the meanwhile, Jean Arthur has... Well, I mean, I guess she knows he's cleaned up his act anyway, so does it really matter if she puts this gangster-adjacent murderer in jail or not?
No, but it's still a sticking point for her until they find out, oh yeah, the dead guy is the gangster.
It's not, though. She tells him that she proposes to him, basically, by saying that then she won't be able to turn evidence against him. It is not a sticking point for her.
Right.
She has abandoned her moral mission here, and again, probably in part because she knows he's come around anyway.
Right. Yeah.
But it is a little uncomfortable that she is doing this, having been our moral guide.
The loop is soon closed. Don't need to prosecute a dead man.
Well, yeah, so that's like the last thread left dangling to prevent us from perfectly enjoying this ending, and then we get to celebrate the fact that this jerk has been murdered by another jerk, and now we have narrative closure.
Yeah, everyone can just start afresh.
I was wondering if Jean Arthur was going to have to give up her law career now after studying for so many years.
Well, but they don't mention that.
They don't mention it, and it's just as plausible that they'll go into husband and wife law business here.
That's what I prefer to imagine. I mean, even when they say that the person's giving up their career, I try to forget about it, like in Easy Living, the only difficult moment in that film. Here, I think we should assume that, yes, they'll open a husband and wife law office or dealing with a totally different kind of clientele. People who have been pushed around by society.
Yeah, they'll use the Kim Wexler version and not make very much money. But as we said, he's not really making money anyway.
He's not in it for the money. He's in it for the thrill of defeating the DA.
The do-gooder.
The public menace.
This is definitely the slightest of the movies.
Yes. So this is a newspaper comedy slash gangster film of sorts. It opens on a ship with Douglas Dumbriel getting his nails done by Jean Arthur. She is a manicurist. We also meet George Murphy, hotshot reporter, thinks he's a hotshot reporter anyway.
They just, until Capra starts getting all these actors on loan, they just don't have much leading man material at Columbia.
Well, George Murphy, a pretty decent career, although he usually plays the other man in movies. We've seen that.
Yeah, I'm talking about leading men.
He did have leads, though.
Not impressive. This is not Joel McRae. Like,
no, I agree.
This is not Charles Boyer.
I agree, but I kind of like what he does in this movie. He's a dope.
Yeah.
I mean, he's perfect as a dope.
It's a comedic performance. I'm just saying she's not really getting her choice of leading men yet.
No, that's right. That's right. Not in The Public Menace for sure. He really, really works well. All the other reporters hate him. And this is actually a really interesting change from what you get in almost every other newspaper comedy I know of, which is, okay, the abrasive reporter is also the best in the business. Now, this guy is not. He's never shown to be any good at his job at all, which I think is amazing. He falls for every trick everyone pulls on him.
He's like one of the sad sacks in the newsroom in His Girl Friday.
Exactly, but it's like, oh, well, why don't we tell a movie about this guy's perspective? Benzinger. That's the kind of guy we're stuck with here. He calls himself the lone wolf, but you know, he never gets the story. He doesn't scoop people.
He's like some kind of bragging incel. Except, I mean, the worst problem with the plot is understanding why she wants to be with this man at all.
Initial impetus is clear enough, although they don't really go into detail. Why is she a Greek citizen rather than an American citizen?
Never, whatever this backstory is never solved.
No. And they say, oh, it's a weird, complicated situation. She's a prisoner on this boat and she can't get off in America because she's not an American citizen apparently, but she feels at home in New York and she's not allowed to go there. So that's her problem when we meet her, and she decides the only way out of it, and there are plenty of movies with this plot, she has to marry an American to, you know, get past Ellis Island.
We saw a pretty great, interesting Virginia Van Epp version of this enforced marriage plot or fake marriage plot, which was is Cafe Society. Much better than this movie.
Yeah, this was the weakest of the three, I think. Although, it had its moments.
Like, even Arthur's performance. It's so interesting. I was, like, watching If You Could Only Cook right after this. It's indefinable what is being done differently. Is William Sider just that much better a comedy director than Erle C. Kenton?
Yes.
You think that's all the difference is? Because her performance is so much better in If You Could Only Cook than in The Public Menace, where everybody is doing the most perfunctory comedy performances possible.
William A. Sider is a great director. I will insist upon this. We've seen Helen's Babies. We've seen Roberta. That's a great movie. He also did You Were Never Lovelier. Plenty of great movies directed by William A. Sider.
So Erle C. Kenton does have one great movie to his credit, which is Island of Lost Souls, which is not a comedy.
Right.
But he also did a lot of Abbott and Costello.
Not exactly the same kind of comedy you want from Gene Arthur.
He began as a writer for Max Sennett, so I guess he is a kind of comedy specialist himself. But yes, maybe not a Gene Arthur type of comedy writer.
Yeah, I do feel like the direction here feels quite indifferent, and I liked his direction of Whirlpool.
Yeah, for sure. But yeah, the writing felt indifferent and the direction felt indifferent.
And her character, you know, there's no attempt to really understand what's going on with her. She's just a scatterbrained liar.
Yeah.
And we've seen Carol Lombard play this kind of character.
Sure, but that's like the whole point of that movie.
Exactly. That movie is much more impressive than this as well. I mean,
that's,
she's complete...
What, True Confessions?
Yeah, she's completely crazy. Yeah. What she's doing, we'll see if you agree, but I have to figure the public menace in this movie is Gene Arthur.
Yeah, of course it is. She's completely crazy, but there's not enough momentum to the direction to even make her performance outstandingly crazy. Ending is outstandingly crazy and completely unmotivated.
It's so after the fact, you always think she's telling the truth, which I think is interesting. Right? It doesn't wink at the audience. Like, every time you think, okay, well, now she's telling the truth. And it's not...
And I'm not even sure, like, when she goes to meet this gangster who put up her bail at the end, is that a plan? Is that her plan to, like, finally have the goods on a gangster so that she can finally really actually get George Murphy's job back? Or is there no plan?
I don't think there's much of a plan. She just figures something's gonna happen that she can make use of. And that's the most interesting part of this character. I mean, nothing gets her down. She just keeps finding a new way to get what she wants. And what she wants first is to be in New York, and then after that it's to be married to George Murphy for no discernible reason.
Maybe she can't do this kind of stylized craziness.
Well, who could, right? Well, who could play this character?
Well, we said Carol Lombard.
Yeah, but it would have to be a slightly different movie. There'd have to be a little bit more going on between her and the audience, right? For us to get a sense of what... Like, Carol Lombard, she makes that face every time she's about to lie in True Confession.
Or Katharine Hepburn's bringing up baby character who's just doing anything that pops into her head to keep Cary Grant there. That's the kind of idea.
Yeah.
But the script is just really weak.
Yeah, it is. Still, there are some good moments in it. The two scenes, one where he thinks she's crying but she's laughing, and the other one where she's crying but he thinks she's laughing.
There's an occasional good joke, yes.
And Douglas Dumbriel is actually quite a menacing gangster in this one.
Although he just like George Murphy decides to believe anything Gene Arthur says, which is a bad idea.
Yeah, but I guess that's the best part of the movie. That's the best joke that keeps working, right? These people are all so stupid because they look at Gene Arthur and they think that she must be this angelic being who could never lie, and she's lying every single moment she opens her mouth in this movie. Often for no reason that any intelligent or awake audience member will understand. That is certainly a problem.
I mean, I guess the problem is that her character makes no sense, and the character arc is all George Murphy's as he overcomes his misogyny, basically.
Yeah, that's a big part of it.
And relatedly, actually manages to score a good story by the end.
Yeah, stumbles into it. Yeah. A midnight phone call tips him off, and he still doesn't even know what he's going to find out.
No, but he does do that whole... Okay, I mean, this movie makes no fucking sense. Because then he does this whole stretcher ambulance routine. scene. He just happens to have a friend who has an ambulance.
Well, no, that's all prepared for long.
Yeah, I know that, but again, I was like, well, we didn't see the part where Jean Arthur meets his friend, but okay. So yeah, he actually is doing everything he possibly can. He has this whole ruse that he's developed with her so he can get this story. But I thought the plan would be to capture this gangster for the cops and have the inside scoop. Instead of which, like a complete maniac, he delivers the gangster, knowing that he has a gun, to the newspaper offices.
Yeah, but that makes a better story. Gangster shootout in the offices of the Bulletin. So he was right.
Yeah, but he doesn't seem to really have that plan.
I think you might be wrong about that. I think
well,
he's expecting...
Well, what he says is, I brought him here so you can interview him.
Well, yeah, that's true. You don't need to interview someone if you get a shootout in a newspaper building. That's a good enough story on its own.
Anyway, unmotivated, makes no sense, but it was a fun scene.
One thing that we have to make note of here is that this film and If You Could Only Cook both have Jean Arthur undergoing a police grilling.
Yeah.
So we're seeing immediate impact of the whole town's talking.
That is the funniest scene in the whole town's talking, her police grilling. And it has, yeah. There's nothing like that in these movies.
No, each version of Jean Arthur under police grilling is totally different from the other two, which is quite interesting.
Well, doesn't she kind of melt down in both of these movies?
To varying degrees. In this one, not really. Yeah, she doesn't really melt down no matter what's going on in this movie. She just tries to lie her way out of it or figure some way. She doesn't have those kinds of deep emotions in this film.
But she does. I mean, she's so attached to George Murphy.
It's not really communicated in an effective way. And George Murphy, on the face of him, doesn't really inspire that kind of feeling in the audience.
And I mean, she is, by the end, all he's really done is decided that, yes, I should marry a hot girl who's all over me, which he should have decided in the first place.
Yeah, he hasn't exactly been living the most thrilling life before, just missing story after story.
His feelings are easier to understand at the end than at any other point in the movie.
Yeah, when he decides to not go through with the divorce proceedings. I like the landlady. She has a nice little bit where she comes up and steals their divorce money.
Yeah, she was very high-handed.
It's a very slight film.
Really doesn't add anything to her persona, doesn't let her give great comic performance.
No, you could probably skip this and not lose a whole lot.
It is funny when you see these wonderful comedians of the era that you think are just, and that are, just absolute geniuses who can't strike a wrong comic note, and then you just see them in a movie where the script is bad or they're not very well directed, and it's like, huh, yeah, they can. They're human. They need a good director. They need a script.
Yeah, exactly. So that's what The Public Menace is good for. You can see Jean Arthur in kind of an undercooked film.
But now...
If You Can Only Cook, on the other hand, terrific movie. This one, we have a Malton review for. I didn't read anything from Malton for the first two because the 1990 TV Movies and Video Guide has no entries for them, which means that they had never shown on TV and they weren't available on home video at that point, which explains why I never saw them. He gives it 3 stars. Arthur and Marshall are a superb team in comedy of wealthy couple pretending to be mobster Carrillo's maid and butler. That's a little bit off. Only one of them is wealthy.
She's also not a maid. Well, I guess she kind of is, though she's primarily... It's advertised for a cook.
Yeah, so we can definitely quibble with Malton's potted review, but I do agree that they make a terrific team. So If You Could Only Cook, as we've mentioned a few times in the lead up to this episode, it was marketed by Columbia in Europe as a Capra film. Capra took offense to this because he didn't direct it.
But also, it's not quite as good as a Capra film.
No, but it is really good. And William A. Sider is a major director in my mind, anyway.
I would say the Capra film it most resembles is Lady for a Day, something like that tone.
Exactly.
Which is a Joe Swirling script. But this is not. This is story by F. Hugh Herbert. Screenwriter is Howard J. Green and Gertrude Purcell, who we've encountered before. She worked on Destry Rides Again.
I've always liked that in Hollywood of the 1930s, there was a Hugh Herbert and they had to have an F. Hugh Herbert. We start out the film with Herbert Marshall, and he is a millionaire industrialist, a self-made car mogul, and he is engaged to be married to a woman that has no interest in him, Frida Inniscord, and you know that's not good because she only plays other women and sort of antagonist type women. The only exception I can think of to that we just saw recently, which is in The Letter, where she's fairly nice as James Stevenson, the lawyer, his wife.
So we get a quick look at this moneyed American world that he is mixing in, and it is very repulsive, and he wants to get away from it.
Yeah, he just doesn't understand how his life has come to this pass. Why is he engaged to this woman? And the movie makes no bones about it. You know, she's joking around, and everyone's joking around about how this is just basically a cash grab on Freeman's Court's part. There's no feeling whatsoever there. When he tries to talk about this with his best friend, the best friend is like, that's very juvenile, isn't it? What, you want to be in love? That's not what getting married is all about. This makes sense.
What do they say? She has family and he has money or something?
Right. So just get with the program and go through with it. It'll be good for the shareholders.
I guess you can have a mistress.
Exactly. Exactly. I guess that's what they would suggest a little further on.
You know, after the honeymoon.
That's right. Then we see that he's not only frustrated in his social life, he's frustrated at work as well. He is the founder of the company. It bears his name, and he's an engineer, so he's not just a money guy.
So the board is creatively blocking him.
Yeah, they're a very stodgy bunch of fucks all around the table. They're saying, this is the depression. We're not going to take chances on new car designs. Let's just keep churning out the old reliables. And he says, that's not what I got in this business for. We want to keep innovating. We want some futuristic cars here. And that's the only fun he can possibly get out of this arrangement that he's entered into with all of these shareholders and various other gatekeepers. And they just have no time for his wild and crazy ideas whatsoever. So he says, well, go ahead. You want to run the company? You're going to block me anyway. So why do you need me here? I'm leaving. And he just wanders off into the park.
We've already known that his fantasy of meeting a girl involves sitting on a park bench and instantly feeling passion.
So he sits there. Jean Arthur happens to be on the bench. Now, he doesn't seem to go to it because he's drawn to her.
No, he's just dazed.
Exactly. But then when he turns around and notices...
Well, she starts talking to him about looking for a job.
Exactly.
She assumes that he's there. Why would a, you know, millionaire or whatever be sitting on this park bench?
Why would any employed man in the middle of the day True. Be sitting on a park bench?
There you go.
And so this is 1935. This is still very much the depression, and jobs are scarce. She's at the end of her rope. We find out during the course of the conversation she has been evicted from her apartment. She has no idea where her next meal or her next bed is going to come from. And Marshall just plays along. I mean, he certainly doesn't volunteer that he's a millionaire, but he doesn't actively try to dissemble very much either. She really controls the conversation. She shoves the classified ad at him, and he notices an ad for a cook, and it's a couple, however. When he talks about cooking, well, she says, well, I'm a whiz at cooking. Are there any ads just for a cook all by themselves? And apparently no. So then she hatches a scheme where, look, we need a job. Is it so distasteful to pretend to be married? I don't think so. Let's just do it.
Well, yeah, so she gives him the hard sell on, you know, trying this new idea and not being afraid.
She just announces it, right? I'm going to sell you on this idea. And he does go along with it. I mean, it's a nice distraction for him.
Well, I think he does want a complete change of life, and this is what she is offering him.
Yeah, now, obviously, this is not a long-term solution, and he doesn't do a Wakefield. He keeps going back to his old life periodically, but he's interested, at least, in trying on a new identity for a few days.
A masquerade, as his butler says.
That's right. It's got some aspects in common with Sullivan's Travels, in a way.
In a way.
Yeah.
Sorry, I just happened to notice as I was looking at the Wikipedia page for this movie that Graham Greene apparently reviewed it under the assumption that it was a Capra film and gave it a negative review.
Right.
Well, on that basis.
Well, yeah, Columbia told them.
He said there were a few agreeable Capra touches. I bet the critics were not happy when they found out they were fooled by this movie.
No, it's... I think Capra sued Columbia. I forget exactly. I know he mentions it in The Name Above the Title, his autobiography, and he was pretty pissed.
This is really Jean Arthur's first Capra movie.
In a way, yeah. It's a little prelude. And I think this is how she came to Capra's attention, as far as I know, right? I think that's how it's introduced in The Name Above the Title. They were falsely representing this movie as a movie that I made, and I watched it just so I could rile myself up even more, and I thought Jean Arthur's the greatest actress who ever lived, and so I need her.
I find it hard to believe he would not have seen her in The Whole Town's Talking.
Well, he probably did. I feel 50 to 60% confident that that's how he broaches the subject of Jean Arthur, in connection with If You Can Only Cook and this whole flap about false advertising. In any event, he did pick her for Mr. Deeds, which comes right after this. So they show up at this suburban, you know, Westchester County manor. We get some comedy beforehand with some other couples who are auditioning for the cook and butler roles.
Well, maybe Capra just, whatever his familiarity with her, maybe he just thought that this was her most fully realized comic performance to date, which it probably is.
It is, of course. So the couples that have preceded them in the interviews, we get a glimpse at what they have to go through, and everyone's talking about how crazy the people are who live here.
Turns out that they are gangsters.
Yeah, it's Leo Carrillo and Lionel Stander, the great Lionel Stander, who would also turn up in Mr. Deeds Goes to Town the next year. Amazing career, ultimately, when you think of it. He was blacklisted for quite a while, but he did make a huge comeback. He plays the agent in New York, New York, Scorsese's New York, New York, and then he was a regular cast member on Heart to Heart.
Oh, that's right. That's where I know that guy from.
I'm Max.
From my childhood.
That voice, I mean.
Well, the voice got more, like, more gravelly.
But it's pretty gravelly from the start.
Here he's kind of the suspicious sidekick to Leo Carrillo's genial head gangster.
He's sort of like William Demarest in Lady Eve.
I was going to say, same.
It's the same dame.
Same idea, except this character's kind of more all over the place, whereas William Demarest is more consistently ornery and a jackass.
Yeah, it's true. Turns out that the sticking point nearly always is an approach to garlic in sauce. And Jean Arthur has the magic touch.
Who knows why? She does not seem very Italian.
She just knows how to make a good sauce. The garlic doesn't just get thrown in. Although, certainly that's what I do. But I don't think I'd get hired by Leo Carrillo either.
So she says that her professor father taught her how to make a good sauce. Or anyway, she had to wait on him, so she learned this.
That's how she learned to cook. She kept house for her dad until he died. When he died, she had to come to the big city, and it's going very badly. They're in, because that's all it takes. Leo Carrillo is ready to hire them. He also likes the way she looks. He makes no secret of that very shortly. Herbert Marshall seems perfect as a butler. He's got a British accent. What more do you need? So they're taken on. They're taken to...
Well, but she actually has the skills that are advertised for. He doesn't, so this is a problem.
Right, but again, in the interview, it doesn't seem to come up, right? No. He's got a cultured accent. What more do you want?
Well, they ask if he's familiar with cars.
Right, and he says, sure, I am. They're shown to the servants' quarters, and of course, there's only one bed, and that's a problem. They can't just sleep in the same bed. They're not going that far in their ruse.
Also, it's the code, so can anyone sleep in the same bed?
Not even a married couple can. But they can't even sleep in the same room if they're not really married. So Jean Arthur makes a plan to have someone sleep on a sort of half sofa out on the porch. Herbert Marshall is very gallant. He's also a millionaire, and he knows he's not going to have to do this for very long, so it doesn't cost him very much, I guess, to... He says they'll flip for it, but he doesn't even show her whether it was heads or tails. He just agrees to take the short end of the stick stuck out on the porch.
But he also wants to sneak out all the time.
Of course, yeah, that helps him.
Got this other life.
He does. He's got this business and this mansion in the city. That's all set. And then we start to find out as we go along, as you mentioned, that these guys are gangsters.
Yeah, so this whole world of these gangsters and this woman looking for a job in the Depression era and this entrepreneur genius, they're all in their own little childlike world in this mansion that is opposed to the world that we saw at the beginning of the movie that Herbert Marshall's trying to escape from.
Yeah, it's very interesting. And this is a very particular type of gangster that we do start to see quite a lot in the second half of the 30s in these kind of comedy crime films. You've got maybe the most famous one is A Slight Case of Murder, and it's, again, same idea. They haven't been committing crimes lately. They're bootleggers, so they've been put out of business by repeal of Prohibition, and they've been sort of resting on their laurels and their huge bank accounts piled up during the Prohibition era, but, you know, they need to get back to criminal activity. And that's what they're talking about yearningly here, or anyway, Leo Carrillo is.
Because they're bored?
Yeah, well, that's what he says.
Well, yeah, what are they going to do?
They don't have any other skills except crime.
You know, read a book? Take up art collecting?
So he gets the boys together. Now, that's a great joke. The build-up to it is that Herbert Marshall has dashed off to the city and done a whole course with his own butler on how to be the perfect gentleman's gentleman.
Buttling, they call it.
Yep. So he learns how to take someone's hat and how to take their coat in the perfect way.
And how to not say what he really thinks, no matter how tedious the employer is.
The real butler tells Herbert Marshall, even though you know it's all drivel, you have to pretend it's of great momentous import. And of course, then he's like, what am I saying here? And Marshall says, don't worry, it's all off the record. So he goes back. He's nervous, right? He feels like he's going to be exposed as an imposter. But this is where we find out for sure that these guys are low-life scum, even though they're ultimately quite nice. But when they all show up, they have no interest in interacting with a proper butler. They just throw their hats at him, and he never even had to go through this course. I thought that was quite hilarious.
They're uncouth.
Exactly.
They're real Americans.
They're not going to judge him one way or the other, as long as he's around and takes stuff away eventually and has a British accent. Yeah. So Marshall overhears the talk about getting back to their criminal activities, and he's like, whoa, these are not very good citizens. We need to get out of here.
His cuckold persona actually has a little cameo in this movie. This is his Blonde Venus moment. That's his whole Blonde Venus performance, where he's a really aggressive cuckold, right? Where he just becomes a self-righteous prick right away.
He gets to show a lot of his different sides in this movie. I think they make a great pair. Gene Arthur's like, okay, quit being so picky, right? We're working for gangsters. So let's just deal with it. As long as they don't force us to break any laws, we'll stick with this job until we can get a different one, maybe. Maybe we'll start looking around. In the meantime, we've got a roof over our heads, which is better than we had yesterday. Marshall has also ordered his butler to tell everyone he's gone fishing, and not fishing for his heart's desire, as is actually true, but fishing for fish. He's checked out of his old life, and it's an open question whether he's ever going to really get back to it or not. Meanwhile, it comes out that Jean Arthur, she has an ideal kind of man in mind for herself, and it's Herbert Marshall, his real identity.
Right.
The self-made millionaire, and she talks about him a lot as if she knows him.
True, but she seems to also be falling for actual, in front of her, Herbert Marshall too.
But it is, for a little while there, a bit of a Superman Clark Kent kind of thing going on.
Sure. I kept wondering if this meant that she knew that this was him, that this was a joke she was playing on him.
Definitely not. No. Definitely not.
But in the beginning, I was wondering from her expression when she was talking about him, James Buchanan.
No, that's my idea of a real man. He's a self-made millionaire. He did all of this. Nothing was handed to him, and he built this enterprise out of his own engineering skill and know-how. You know, what's wrong with you? Why aren't you like that? That's the implied drift of that conversation. A little bit of a sticking point for Marshall there. He, as always in this kind of movie, he wants her to love him for himself rather than for past achievements.
Right. I mean, I guess the whole point of that interest of hers is he has to have some motivation for not just immediately telling her I'm a millionaire as soon as like the novelty wears out.
Exactly.
And
exactly.
Asking her to marry him.
It's a necessary aspect of the plot. I'm not sure it goes that well with the rest of what we know about Jean Arthur's character, but she sells it and she gets a lot of fun comedy out of it as well, as she pretends to know something about this guy that of course she's only read about in the newspapers, and it borrows a little on the liar aspect of her public menace character, but it's more grounded in this one and just more obviously useful to the enterprise of getting these characters together in an interesting way.
So it's very hard for me to quantify why her performance in this movie is so much better than in the public menace. I mean, her character makes more sense, that does help. Maybe the budget was higher or something. I mean, she's got Herbert Marshall's, you know, he's probably a bigger star than George Murphy.
Of course he is.
Probably. This is probably more of an A production, and they seem to have taken their time, and there's just so much more precision to her comic line readings.
Oh yeah, and the camera setups are more carefully arranged. She looks amazing in this movie, I think.
Yeah.
Obviously, Columbia has decided, okay, now we're 100% investing in this person. She is going to be our biggest star.
Why would they decide that just at this moment? Is it because of Diamond Jim? Because then she goes into the public menace. But that could have been planned already.
Exactly, exactly. When you have a production schedule and you're putting people in 5-6 movies a year, sometimes you don't have time to take stock in the middle, right? You just put them into it. But clearly, If You Could Only Cook was designed as the capper of 1935.
And as the capra.
That's right.
1935.
The capper and the lead in to the capra. Eventually, though, I find it, like, what a fascinating development. I didn't know what was going on with Herbert Marshall breaking into his own office and raiding the...
Well, is he breaking in or does he have, like, a key?
Well, yeah, I know, but what's he going there for, right? They're keeping a close watch. Lionel Stander, anyway, is keeping a close watch on this new couple. And he's like, hey, don't you think it's a little weird that our new servant couple sleep in separate rooms? One of them sleeping on the porch? And Leo Carrillo is like, if they want to live that way, leave them alone.
I don't know what he's implying, but live what way, but...
Sexlessly, obviously.
Yeah, just don't judge their asexuality.
That's right. But of course, it's exciting to Leo Carrillo because he's fallen head over heels in love with Jean Arthur, and he likes the idea that this is not an actively sexual marriage.
Right.
So he buys her a very frilly outfit. Just as a thank you for getting the garlic right, he says.
Very Hollywood movie star type cape here.
And he says, there's no string attached here, but you gotta take it from me. And she says, well, at first she says, well, my husband wouldn't like this. And he talks her into just trying it on. And then, of course, he goes in for a kiss immediately. So there seem to be some strings on there. She's trying to fend him off when Marshall walks in. And
yeah, this is where he goes into his
very angry
jackass mode.
And yeah, as they extricate themselves from that and they go back to the servants' quarters, he says, well, you seem to be
the whole situation.
Now, she tells him off and makes it clear that she wasn't enjoying it.
Well, she said she had it under control, though. She said she knows this type of man and he's not dangerous, basically.
She proves to be correct. So the movie doesn't undercut her knowledge of men here. She's presumably met some men who are not okay. She'd handle that differently. But still, the movie makes it clear it's not right for her to have to deal with this and make these judgments every day about how dangerous the man who's throwing himself at her today happens to be.
But this does become an opportunity for her to realize that he has feelings for her because he's taking this husband masquerade very seriously.
He's making noises like a husband.
He sure is. That's from Detour. Thanks for anyone who doesn't know that reference. That's a great line. And Savage.
She starts making noises like a wife, however, when he keeps disappearing in the middle of the
night. She does.
And this is the big disappearance for him. Now, Lionel Stander, again, his radar is up, right? Because he knows they didn't come across in the Mauritania. That's what they told him. That's why they have no references, because their luggage was lost.
He wants references. Leo Carrillo does not care about that.
He just wants the good garlic sauce.
He doesn't care who these people are. And he's right. Like, who cares?
That's right. But...
Well, he even says at one point, they just lied to get a job. It's
we're
depression.
Crooks. We know about this. No, Stander wants to find out. He just thinks, maybe he thinks, you know, these guys are G-men or something, right? Trying to get the goods on them so that they can be prosecuted for
it's
their
very
former
suspicious.
Activities. That's the way I took it anyway. There's this possibility that they could be spies, right? Not just liars.
But when he tails Marshall and sees him stealing from this office, that's when he decides that this guy's a wise guy and he's cooling it, just hiding out in this butler role.
Exactly. I mean, that's what you'd have to assume, right? If he just waltzed in, broke into a safe immediately, like, how do you do that?
Why would you assume that he is the owner of the company?
You can't assume that. And why
because that would be completely insane for him to be working as your butler.
That's right. And then why would Marshall do this? Well, we find out eventually. But I actually didn't realize what he was doing. I didn't understand it until he gets home. He presents Jean Arthur with all of his sketches for the new cars that were turned down by the board.
Right, because he has told her that he has all these great ideas that no one will pay attention to, which is true.
And she says, yeah, whatever. If you were a real man, you would have gotten your cars made and you'd be just like the man of my dreams, Buchanan.
But it turns out she doesn't really believe that. She's happy to try to make this happen for the man she loves. His career goals she will push on his behalf. How she even gets in to see this rival car company owner, I have no idea. We're not shown that.
She's resourceful. That's all we need to know. So she's just won over. You know, I'll show you my etchings or whatever. This is...
of cars yet.
This really did it. you know, she's been falling in love with him anyway, and she's been jealous about his nocturnal adventures.
So we saw a nascent plot of this type we took note of in, which movie was it? Whirlpool? Where she was trying to help out her boyfriend or something? There was something where she was trying to get a story published. The whole town's talking. We were saying that it had this nascent plot where she was going to help Edward G. Robinson achieve his career dreams, and then she just instead disappears from the movie.
Right. Well, that's true. Yeah, I mean, she starts acting like a manager to Edward G. Robinson, and she's kind of doing that here too. So she's like, okay, well, this guy's a great engineer. I love him for all kinds of other reasons, but he just doesn't have what it takes to get ahead in the business world, so I'm going to do that part for him.
She's a manager, mentor, mother.
That's right. And so she says, okay, let's meet up in the city tomorrow at my favorite dive, waffle joint. I've got things to do, so we can't really see each other until then. Why don't you take a nap since you've been off collecting your sketches
maybe
all night?
She's actually just made up this James Buchanan crush to make Herbert Marshall jealous.
Yeah, I think so, right? To goad him into some kind of creative activity.
Manly act.
Yeah. When next we see her, she is meeting with a rival car company's owner or some highly placed executive, and she places all of the sketches in front of them. They are impressed, but they think they see the fine Italian hand of Buchanan.
And also his signature. His initials, anyway.
JB, yeah. He's been going by Burns, James Burns, but then there's a conference and everyone agrees at the Atlas car company that this is clearly a Buchanan design. So they call the cops on her and she gets arrested for being in possession of these top secret car blueprints.
Stolen.
Yeah. And they have been stolen because Herbert Marshall didn't tell anyone he was doing this. And so the Buchanan company has reported a break-in. Once again, we see Jean Arthur under the glare, scrutiny of the men in blue.
And this causes her to miss her appointment with Herbert Marshall, where he's going to reveal everything, which is apparently all he needs, just this one missing of an appointment to decide to go back to his former life.
No, it's not that. But let's go back to that in a second, because here you get kind of this is a great sort of transitional moment between the more emotional Jean Arthur that we know and love from her mature period, which kind of starts here, and, you know, the scene in The Whole Town's Talking, which was the best scene for her, where she refuses to divulge anything to the cops. Here, again, she refuses to implicate Herbert Marshall. They can't break her down. They try, but she's also not sassing them. She's upset.
Yeah.
But still, she doesn't break, right, under questioning. And she has no reason to protect him at this point because she thinks he's a crook, right? How did he get these designs? So she makes up all kinds of other stories. She just found them on the street, etc., etc. Anything to make sure that he doesn't get hauled in as well. So that's real devotion. And Marshall, he's been lectured by his best friend. Again, this best friend sucks. Because Marshall tells him everything about what he's been doing, and the best friend says, oh yeah, great, marry this non-entity, jilt Frieda Innescourt.
Yeah, it's like a plot point from the TV show Succession. It's like, you do this, you marry this inappropriate person, the stock's gonna crash because of the shareholders. You can't be too respectable as the president of a major corporation.
He has done something quite crazy from the point of view of the general public. He has posed as a butler and fallen in love with a woman that he lied about being married to as they got this job.
Well, my read was more that they were just talking about the class disparity in general.
His friend says, if this gets into the papers, yeah, the stuff about jilting Frieda Innescourt is going to be bad, but even worse is going to be this whole story about you pretending to be a butler and marrying Jean Arthur. This is the end of the company if you do this.
So you don't think there's like no class disparity point made at all?
Well, I didn't see...
She's just a random girl on a park bench.
It just seems crazy, regardless, right? And so he gets talked into that like he's going to be unfair to the company. And he realizes, or he thinks he realizes, that this is the best course of action. That's what he's intending to tell Jean Arthur at their lunch meeting. But she's not there because she's in custody of the police.
Still, this seems like a faithless act.
Well, yeah, I agree. I mean,
and the whole ending, you know, often these screwball comedy or wacky romantic comedy, masquerade comedy endings things are very, very, very weird tonally, and this is no exception. This is a really weird ending to
the movie. It is.
And it goes on for a long time.
Yeah, but it has a lot of good moments in it. I agree that it's...
The gangsters are gangsters ex machina.
That's right. Again, sort of like Lady for a Day, but in a different way. It also is an opportunity for Jean Arthur to have, I think, her best scene, in fact.
What year is Lady for a Day?
33.
Okay. So this movie could be definitely calling back to that.
Lionel Stander finds Herbert Marshall's note saying, I wish I had had a chance to meet you for lunch in person and tell you this, that I'm not the man you think I am. I'm sorry. Goodbye. Leo Carrillo springs all of this on her. Again, he's hoping that there's going to be room in her heart for him now. He proposes and also mentions that he's going to have Herbert Marshall whacked. I mean, it's such a ridiculous, stupid situation. But her performance, I think, is so good. It's actually heartbreaking when she realizes they're going to kill Herbert Marshall. And she conjures, she brings real emotions into that scene that really doesn't have anything to do with any kind of real world scenario.
And she's like so angry at him before that because of this whole masquerade with the stolen designs that are actually his. And now he's going to marry this other woman. And she just gets furious with him, but then breaks down afterwards.
It's an amazing scene. I think it's the best scene we've had from her in any of the movies.
She does that pacing thing.
It's so good. And it affects Leo Carrillo as well. He's like, okay, well, we'll forget it. We won't rub him out. We're going to do something else.
She definitely brings more believable, real emotion. And I guess that makes sense. Goes along with Elizabeth Kendall's thesis about the romantic comedy heroine that she thinks starts with Capra's movies at Columbia, right? It makes sense that she has so much more believable, invested emotion that the audience can see than Herbert Marshall does.
Yeah, I mean, it's about her. I mean, Herbert Marshall, they just borrowed him to play a butler. I mean, I think he's really good in the movie, but this is about making Jean Arthur happen as a star.
Yeah.
And it worked. The gangsters break into the wedding, so we don't have a runaway bride. We have a kidnapped groom. I don't think I've ever seen that in a movie before.
There's that whole weird segment where the cops stop them in the just married car, and the two gangsters on either side of Herbert Marshall are pretending to be a lovey-dovey newlyweds, and the cops are like voyeuristically listening in.
Yeah.
I don't know if you could call it voyeurism if they're listening, but anyway, they're clearly getting sexually excited by listening to this. And Herbert Marshall's sitting in the middle with this weird sort of smarmy expression on his face.
It is very strange. So they drag him back to the Carrillo mansion. They get Jean Arthur out. This is supposed to just fix everything. He's very happy. Herbert Marshall's like, okay, great. I had no way out of this marriage and you guys kidnapped me and I'm so grateful. Thank you so much. And he's ready to marry Jean Arthur immediately.
But he's also showing, like, no emotions and also tells them to make it happen when psychologically and emotionally it would have to be him doing it. So it's like one of these, you know, actually persuading her. And we don't get that scene. Like, I think a better movie would have that scene. But on the other hand, this is like some kind of, I don't know, this just, it fits more with the comic genre to have this sort of elaborate ending with all of these deus ex machinas involved. But for the movie to have more emotional impact, there would have to actually be a scene between the two of them, and that's deliberately avoided.
Yeah, because I think the focus, the emotional high point is her prior scene when she realizes, I have to do something or they're going to kill Herbert Marshall. And once that's taken care of, the rest is just comedy.
Yeah, I guess.
And that's clearly what they wanted to go with here. It's a way for Herbert Marshall to get back at the gangster and find a way to make them feel like they're behind the eight ball a little bit. If they don't help to arrange this marriage, he's gonna ensure that they're all executed for kidnapping.
Yeah, another kidnapping.
I know.
Different kidnapping angle here.
When he goes to the door, Jean Arthur not answering it. We've seen this a million times. The gangsters get in on it and they wind up hitting on the idea of pretending to shoot Herbert Marshall. And, of course, that's all she needed. It's, again, sort of a callback. The threat to his mortality is the only thing that's going to, you know, counter her damaged pride here at being lied to by this millionaire creep. And she runs out, and we don't really see anything beyond her going to check on his supposedly shot body. And, of course, he's not shot, so everything's going to be fine for them, and they'll live happily ever after.
And I guess he needs to undergo a symbolic death for all of the trouble he's given her.
So it would seem. Yeah, and I guess that's where we end 1935 with Gene Arthur. On the whole, a really good movie, I think. But yeah, it has some limitations, the way it brings everything to a close. I don't think it's a failure of execution. I think it's a sort of limited conception of what they wanted to do here. Capra, of course, never has that. Capra is treating every single movie like he's trying to hit the biggest home run of all time. And he wouldn't do anything so rote.
And he wanted to, he'd want to overload every scene with emotional expressiveness.
Exactly.
Which is finally actually achieved as a cinematic goal in It's a Wonderful Life.
Yeah. So you can see why he would be pissed off. This is a pretty by-the-numbers romantic comedy conclusion.
And yet, as I said, in the attention to detail to the performances, and particularly Gene Arthur's performance, such a cut above The Public Menace.
Yeah, no, I think if you're gonna go with this script, I can't imagine it being done better. So William A. Sider, that's what you go to him for. You don't necessarily go to him for visionary work. But you go to him for the best possible take on what you've handed to him as a script.
I guess the only thing I'd add is that they do get a funny sort of meta depression comedy moment when the gangsters ask her how she got into this whole mess of being involved with these stolen designs. And she's like, she starts to give an explanation, and then she's just like, the depression.
I've heard a lot of things blamed on the depression. All in all, just a really fun movie, not to be missed. Now we're hitting the movies that, you know, you can't miss any of them for Gene Arthur, I think.
So I happened to look at a couple of essays online on Gene Arthur while I was doing research. One of them is in Bright Lights Film Journal.
Oh, Dan Callahan.
You know of the work of Dan Callahan?
Yeah, I follow him on Facebook.
And he's written some movie books, biographies. So it's called Uneasy Living, The Insecure Charm of Gene Arthur. Yeah, he's written several movie books, some of them biographies. And then the other one was Kim Morgan's Criterion Collection essay, Gene Arthur, the Nonconformist. I thought it was just interesting that Callahan seems to be really emphasizing what his takeaway, well, among other things, his takeaway on Arthur is that she plays tough, but she never is convincingly tough. Whereas Kim Morgan seems to be emphasizing more that she can actually be tough. She actually quotes from a 1936 issue of Screen and Radio Weekly that was promoting The Plainsman, where Gene Arthur plays Calamity Jane, says that Arthur authored an essay entitled Who Wants to Be a Lady? And the quote here is, "Women would have been emancipated long ago if it hadn't been for the tyranny of the ladylike, a false ideal and standard of deportment. Isn't it true that Mae West's heroines, Katharine Hepburn's tomboy characters, Betty Davis's waitresses, and other tough characterizations have helped millions to be more indulgent toward women who are not coy, kittenish, or too gentle? The movies have made the world more tolerant, proved that this is as much a woman's world as a man." I don't know, like, this could definitely be written by a publicist. I'm not sure if she really wrote this. She could have. But I think it probably correctly captures her sentiments and reasons for wanting to play a character like Calamity Jane. I don't know that Betty Davis's performance in Of Human Bondage really fits in this mix of performances that would make the world more tolerant towards tough women.
Yeah, but that's not the only...
Many other Betty Davis roles, but not that one in particular. I don't know any other. When else did she play a waitress?
Well, maybe Petrified Forest.
She's not very tough in that movie. Anyhow, other than that. But I just thought it was interesting because two different movie writers have such different takes on Gene Arthur.
I think it does a disservice to claim that she's not convincingly tough. I think she is, but also incredibly tender at the same time. That's the magic of Gene Arthur, that she's both.
Well, that's what I was saying earlier, that she has this androgynous quality that is very convincing in certain parts, and that was obviously important to her in her life. But at the same time, she is always so feminine.
She's just completely unique. And we're gonna start seeing that more and more as we encounter films that are built more and more around the persona that she's developing.
What I thought was interesting idea that Dan Callahan contributes toward question of Gene Arthur's persona, he really emphasizes how she, and I don't think we've seen this yet, I think this will be when she starts working more with auteurs and gets more and more important movies, but that she has a quality on screen of being a fantasist, of being in her own own private world, and that's part of the reason he thinks she works well with Gary Cooper,
mm-hmm.
that they share this quality. Now, preeminently among all actresses from this era, the one who has that quality the most, in my opinion, is Jennifer Jones. She absolutely seems like she's completely in her own private world in many of the movies she appears in, and is sharing it with nobody, although Joseph Cotten always strikes me as a co-star who is most capable of sort of inhabiting an adjacent world, like letting her still be in her own world, but sort of communicating with her in it.
Well, because he understands about another kind of distance.
But yes, I think this is probably also true of Jean Arthur. And she, of course, does this with more of a comic persona. So that'll be interesting to keep our eyes out for.
Got a lot of great stuff ahead. Our next Jean Arthur episode will be The Ex-Mrs. Bradford, which is an excellent movie with William Powell. It's kind of a Thin Man type movie. And Adventure in Manhattan.
Really?
Mr. Deeds Goes to Town also comes along during this. You know, it would have been covered by us if we hadn't already covered it, so I'm sure we'll have some words to say about it.
Oh, darn it, because I thought that was coming up next, and I was actually looking forward to viewing it as part of this series. I forgot that we'd ruled that out. I was totally ready to see it again.
Well, we could watch it again. I don't mind. I always like watching
especially
it.
Especially after reading that Callahan essay.
All right, well, you heard it here first. We might also actually watch Mr. Deeds, and we might not give a full discussion since we've already done that, but specially honed in on Jean Arthur. So yeah, you might be seeing an amendment on the schedule. We might actually put Mr. Deeds Goes to Town right back on the schedule for a second kick at the can. Next week on the podcast, it is our August special subject, the German Cirque Sampler.
Ooh.
Part one. We'll be watching The Girl from the Marsh Croft, 1935, and Pillars of Society, 1936. Neither of us, I don't think, has any idea what to expect here.
Nope.
This is Douglas Sirk making movies under the Nazi regime.
What is that going to look like?
We're going to find out together next week.